Ladies and gentlemen, I am indeed extremely honored and privileged that the Pune International Center has invited me to launch the lecture series on policy making in India. When we talk of policy, the first question which comes to mind is, what exactly is policy and how do you define policy in this country? There have been many policies, and policies are a dime a dozen and being made almost every day. But there are two which have been real game changers in the last three decades. The first one, of course, was the major shift in the philosophy of economic policy in 1991. Economic and industrial policy. And that was a true game changer in our history. And the second that I will pick up will be the nuclear tests of 1998 and the subsequent evolution of the nuclear doctrine that India has adopted. Then there have been any number of policy shifts, changes, this, that and the other. But I would not say that they have been game changers in the same way in which these two policies have been. In 1990-91, as many of you will recall, I was briefly the finance minister in the Chandrasekhar government. And that was the crisis, the like of which I have never seen in my long administrative or political career. When after 4 months, Chandrasekhar was forced to resign. To make two, 3 points. The first is, 1991 was a game changer year as far as economic direction of the country was concerned. And therefore, without going into who was responsible, who was not responsible, there are a few things that we must recall to mind. One, it was not voluntary, it was not deliberate, it was a response to a crisis. Two, that despite that crisis, which the country has never faced before and I hope will never face in future, despite that crisis, politics intervened in such a way that the government of the day, the finance minister of the day, was prevented from presenting a budget. What happened to the reforms of 91? Like a ship, they ran aground just 2 years later. Because again politics intervened, it was not national politics, it was the politics within the Congress Party which was in power at that point of time. Why? Because, and this is the first lesson that we have to learn as far as policy making in this country is concerned, is that politics overtakes everything. It is not the economy is stupid. It is the politics is stupid. This is the long history of economic reforms that we have seen in the last 25 years. And I was telling Vijay that even a political opponent of the present regime, like the Chief Minister of Bihar, Nitish Kumar, has said that the government of India has certain responsibilities. Who will look at equity at all India level? Who will look at social justice at all India level? Who will be responsible for anything special for the backward regions of this country? Who will be responsible for the class differences which exist in our country? Can the government of India relieve itself of all the responsibilities? I don't think it is going to be possible in a country like India. So the government of India schemes will remain, some of them. And the devolution of funds will have to remain. But how will they be distributed and how will the states start spending on the schemes which they will be masters of are all issues which will remain in the future. But coming back to the issue of economic reforms, there was a lot that we did in the time that we were in government from 1998 to 2004. But if you ask me today, do we have a national consensus for economic reforms? My question is a big no. I don't see any consensus on economic reforms taking place in a hurry, because the accepted policy of every political party in this country has been, I will support reforms when I am in government, I will oppose reforms when I am in opposition. So it is politics all the way. And I am coming to now the nuclear tests and the nuclear doctrine to show how politics was playing a role even then. The Bharatiya Janata Party had talked about India going nuclear in a session that they had in Patna in 1964. And that was the commitment of the Bharatiya Janata Party, that India should become nuclear. And in 1998, when Mr. Vajpayee became the Prime Minister of India, you were all aware that a few weeks after assuming charge as Prime Minister, he went for the nuclear tests. And I now don't remember whether it was 10 days before the nuclear tests or 15 days before the nuclear tests, but he said that you have to be ready for the fallout of that event. And then the tests happened on the 11th and 13th of May. And then we had a meeting with the Prime Minister, 5-6 of us, and we decided the future course of action. Then came the economic sanctions. But the policy was the important thing, the nuclear doctrine of India. And as far as the doctrine is concerned, it is something which has been, which went through the mill, because a number of experts contributed to the evolution of the nuclear doctrine. I had moved to the Ministry of External Affairs by then. I recall to mind Mr. Jaswant Singh, who had gone to the Ministry of Finance, had a major contribution to me to the evolution of the nuclear doctrine. The issue came up before the Cabinet Committee on Security. It was discussed there in detail, and then it was adopted as national policy. Now, from these few examples, 1991, economic reforms was a handiwork of the officials serving in the Ministry of Finance and of the political input which the Prime Minister of the day would have received from his political colleagues in the cabinet. But as you are aware, budget making continues to be a secret, ultimately a policy decision taken by the finance minister and the prime minister. This is how the 1991 reforms took place. The industrial policy reforms were, history tells us, largely on account of the initiative taken by the Prime Minister, Mr. Narasimha Rao, who was also the Industries Minister, and his principal secretary, Amarnath Verma. These were the two people who were largely responsible for the industrial policy reforms of 1991. Now, if anyone thinks that a lot of thinking goes into policy making, then I like to disabuse your mind of such a notion. And that is why policy making in our country has been a series of hits and misses. Policy making has been ad hoc. Policy making has been confined to a few people and a team. Policy making has rarely been the outcome of a lot of thinking, a lot of inputs being marshaled and taking into account what is going to happen in future. One of the last points which I'd like to make, I wanted a village to be electrified. And it's part of the policy, Rajiv Gandhi Gramin Vidyutikaran Yojana. So take the line, it was with great difficulty that the Department of Electricity or the Electricity Board agreed to my request to take, to erect the poles, mount the wires, and take the line to that village. Okay. Then suddenly, a ranger of the Forest Department woke up and he said, you can't do this. This is a wildlife sanctuary and you have not taken care to protect the wild animals. The only wild animal in that forest, which was already destroyed, would have been no more than a dog. But they said the height of the line should be such that if an elephant were to cross, he will not touch the wires. So I hummed and hawed, but there was nothing I could do. This proposal then had to go to the State Wildlife Board, headed by the Chief Minister. It took something like 10-12 months for that board to meet and take a view on this. They took a positive view, okay, but they didn't have the final powers. So it had to go to the National Wildlife Board, of which there was a subcommittee headed by the Minister for Environment and Forest. So in Delhi, I spoke to the minister, I spoke to the secretary of the ministry, I said, please take this on the agenda. It has come from the government of Jharkhand. Please take this on the agenda and approve it. There is nothing to it. So after 6-8 months, they took it on the agenda and it was approved. Then it took another 3 months for them to communicate it to the government of Jharkhand. Then the Damodar Valley Corporation, which is responsible for rural electrification, they had to prepare a project report on how much more it's going to cost to provide all the protection to wildlife. So they came out with some figure, 3 crore or 5 crore or something. So I said, who will now sanction it? They said that you speak to the chairman of the Rural Electrification Corporation. So I spoke to the chairman of the rural, he said, I will pass it on, but who will finally approve it? There is a committee headed by the Power Secretary of the Government of India, which will finally approve it. So I, like a fiend, I was after the Power Secretary, please approve it, please approve it. Finally it got approved. When finally it got approved, and I thought I had fought my last battle, then I was told it will have to go to the National Green Tribunal for a because it's a wildlife sanctuary. So, National Green Tribunal. And I was telling Vijay, that's when I gave up. And mind you, I did not advise the villagers to do what they did. They just took law into their own hands and connected the village with electricity. And nobody has bothered. The village is now electrified. So the last point that I was making was, to make whatever kind of policy you make, implementation of that policy or implementability of that policy is most important. And if Adam Smith's economic man does not exist anymore, then please remember the character and efficiency of the people who are going to implement your policies. And therefore, you know, I went to the net to collect how many national policies. And if somebody in the PIC or elsewhere could do an exercise, it will be worthwhile to find out how many national level policies we have. We have national level policy on agriculture, on industry, on transport, population, health, education, telecom, cyber security, climate change, children, senior citizens, forest, women. Think of it, and now we have Panchamrit, Act East, any number of national policies. And we have any number of national level schemes. Ultimately, where do we get stuck? We get stuck at the level of implementation. And therefore, I will say one, our policies are made in a very ad hoc fashion, except maybe the 5-year plans where a lot of input goes. Most policies are the handiwork of a few people most policies could be the result of somebody's brainwave. But most policies fail because they are not implemented properly on the ground. And this is where partnership, not only in policy making, but partnership in policy implementation becomes very important. And when I'm talking of partnership, I'm not merely confining myself to the Government of India and the state governments. I'm also talking of the local bodies at the district level, at the block level, and at the panchayat level. And it's my firm belief, it's my very firm belief that policies which are within the jurisdiction, territorial jurisdiction of a panchayat, of a district, or of the state, should be left to be made by them. They will make the policies, they will be responsible for their implementation. They will have no alibis. Today, we have lots of alibis, and fixing responsibility for the failure of a policy is something which is unknown in the Government of India. And I'm sure it's the same story in the states also. So you make a mistake, you get away with it. You fail, you get away with it. You don't implement, you get away with it. And now, with as somebody was saying, with 13(1)(d) of the Anti-Corruption Act, most important disincentive why a civil servant will not act. So that is my take on policy making in India and its implementation. And I hope you'll have many more learned lectures on this subject as we go along. Thank you very much.